Yeah, let's start. Very good evening to good afternoon to all the participants as well as the review committee members for joining the very very important session, that is oral presentation from the young researchers, faculty members and postdoctoral fellows. Thank you all for joining, and now the session is over to Dr. Sunita Nayak, the faculty members from CBCMT Vellore Institute of Technology. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Loganathan. Good afternoon, all of you. Once again, I welcome you all to the series of this oral presentation of this conference. The reviewer of this session are Dr. Ronak Kumar Das, Dr. Amit Kumar Jaiswal, Dr. Satya Prakash Agrahari, and Dr. Arun Kumar. As mentioned earlier in the previous oral presentation, total 10 minutes time will be given to each presentation. Out of this total 10 minutes, eight minutes will be for presentation and 2 minutes will be for question and answers. To start with, I'd like to invite P. Rajalakshmi from PG and Research Department of Chemistry, Loyola College, University of Madras, for the first presentation. Please, ma'am, share your screen.
Yes, ma'am. I start, ma'am. Hello, shall I start, ma'am, now?
Yes, please go ahead, madam.
Thank you. Good afternoon to one and all present here. This is P. Rajalakshmi from Department of Chemistry, Loyola College, Chennai 34. So here, let me take an opportunity to thank the organizers for giving me a chance to present my work. So the topic of mine is bioactive random copolyesters, synthesis, characteristics, and anti-cancer activity studies. So this is the outline of my work: introduction, scheme of synthesis, spectral analysis, physicochemical properties, molecular weight determination by GPC, thermal analysis by TGA and DSE, cell viability in HEK293 cells and cytotoxicity in HepG2 cancer cells by MGT assay, and conclusion. In current situation, the need for biomaterials has significantly increased in order to overcome life-threatening diseases like cardiovascular disease or cancer, and to improve the quality of the human health and life. Bioactive synthetic polymeric materials are the prime focus for the researchers due to their tunable mechanical and structural properties. Aliphatic polyesters are significantly used in pharmaceutical technology as drug carriers and tissue engineering scaffolds because of their lower cytotoxicity, biocompatibility, and biodegradability. In a physiological condition, the aliphatic polyesters would fission into a dissolvable pieces and would be absorbed or metabolized in vivo. They have been approved as an implantable biomaterials by Food and Drug Administration, FDA, of many countries. In our present work, polyalkylene glutarate co-sebacate, a set of three aliphatic random copolyesters, was synthesized through solvent-free, catalyst-free melt polycondensation method. So here, this is a scheme of my synthesis. Here, the sebacate and glutarate acids are the two common monomers were chosen, and the aliphatic linear short chain diol, that 1,2 ethane diol, propane diol, and butane diol, were used for the synthesis of random copolyesters. Here we followed a melt polycondensation method, and the temperature we followed at 150 degrees Celsius, and this is the prepared polyester, and three polyesters were prepared in this methodology. Once the polyesters were prepared, the structure of the polyester is confirmed with the help of the spectral, with the help of these FTIR, H1 NMR, and C13 NMR studies. So here, this is the FTIR spectra of the bioactive random copolyesters. All the polyesters had shown a characteristic absorption peak at around 1,733 centimeter inverse. This is a peak that arises due to the ester carbonyl group of the polyester molecule. And the CH symmetrical stretching and asymmetrical stretching, it's giving you a peak at around 2,900 to 2,700 meter inverse. And the reasonable amount of a terminal broad OH peak, it's obtained at around 3,447 centimeter inverse. So from the FTIR spectra, the polyester structure has been confirmed. And this can also be further confirmed, and the incorporation of all the monomers can also be confirmed with the help of this H1 NMR spectra of the bioactive random copolyesters. So this is the stacked H1 NMR, and here we're able to see the incorporation of all the three monomers. The most deprotected methylene protons present in a diol moiety, it's giving you a peak at around 4.4 ppm, and the methylene protons present in the position next to the carbonyl group of the acid moiety gives you a peak at around 2.4 ppm, and the protons present in the beta position to the carbonyl group, it's giving you a peak at around 1.7 ppm. So the large shielded protons of the sebacic acid moiety, it's giving you a large peak at around 1.3 ppm. And this is a peak at around 7 ppm. And the spectra of polyester, this also further confirms the structure of the polyester molecules. And here, the deprotected protons, it's giving you a peak at around 64 to 67 ppm, and the carbonyl group of the polyester molecule, it's giving you a peak at around 174 ppm, and this is a peak that arises due to the solvent. So once the polyester structures were confirmed, the next step is to study about their physicochemical properties. The need for it is to check their available application in a biomedical field. So we did that miscibility test and inherent viscosity test. So the polyesters were found to be soluble in a wide range of organic solvents and were found to be insoluble in a non-polar solvent, NXN, and a polar solvent, distilled water. So their insolubility in an aqueous medium and their solubility in a wide range of solvents helps them to find their application in a drug carrier systems. And they may also enhance the bioavailability of the hydrophobic drugs. And here, this is an UBOL viscometer. Using this, we found out the inherent viscosity of the three polyesters. All the three polyesters are given you on a range of values, and it lies in agreement with the molecular weight. As the molecular weight increases, the inherent viscosity value also increases. And this is the GPC analysis. Using that, we found out the number average molecular weight and weight average molecular weight of the polyesters. And we, using that MEL polycondensation method and the solvent-free catalyst-free method, we able to prepare a low molecular weight. Successfully, we prepared a low molecular weight polyesters. And here also, we able to see that odd even effect in their molecular weight value. The molar mass dispersity index also give you a range in the set of 1.45 to 1.78. The thermal studies. So here, to find the availability of the drug carriers, to find out their stability and to find out their application in a drug carrier system, the melting point and the glass transition temperature are playing a great role. So here, the glass transition temperature of the polyesters lies below that of the physiological temperature, and they are all have very good low melting point liquids. And these three data, it give you an idea about the stability of the polyesters, and these data were obtained from the thermogravimetric analysis. The polyester, the 5% decomposition of the polyester, it starts at around 250 degrees Celsius, and the polyester, the char temperature, it starts at around 450 degrees Celsius. So the polyesters are quite stable and they're able to be used for the further analysis, for the further studies. And here we go for that important analysis that is the most needed one for any biomaterial to check about its application. The biocompatibility should be tested. Here we tested the biocompatibility of the polyester cells at different concentration. For all the polyesters, by varying the different concentrations, we found out their cell viability, and it is found to be more than 80%. And the increase in concentration and molecular weight did not show any significant influence on the cell viability of the polyesters on the normal human cells. So as a conclusion, they are all biocompatible in nature. Now we move on to their application. So we thought of finding out their cytotoxicity effect in a cancer cells. We found out that cytotoxicity effect of the polyesters in a human liver cancer cell, HepG2. So here the polyesters at different concentrations were tested. As we increase the concentration of the polyester, the cytotoxicity value is also increasing. By further increasing their concentration, sure, we may be able to get a more cytotoxic effect on the cancer cells. The polyesters with even number diol unit, the ethane diol unit and propane diol unit, were found to be more cytotoxic and had shown more molecular weight dependent cytotoxic effect on the human liver cancer cells. And this is a comparative study that we did that study with the normal cell and the cancer cell. Just the IC50 values were compared here. We were able to see a huge difference between their IC50 values. Here for the normal cells, they are giving a value at around 800, 500 and 600 microgram. And for this FG2 cancer cells, their values are very low. So this represents their high cytotoxic effect. So the IC50 value clearly shows that the synthesized polyesters are molecular weight dependent, biocompatible molecules, and chain length dependent anti-cancer active molecules. The conclusion of the work, So here the polyalkylene glutarate co-sebacate, a set of three aliphatic random co-polyesters, were successfully synthesized. The ester linkage and structure of the polyesters were confirmed by FTIR, H1 NMR and C13 NMR studies. MTT cell viability assay on HEC-293 cells and HEBG2 cancer cells represents the targeted cytotoxic effect and anti-cancer activity of the synthesized polyesters against the human liver cancer cells. The positive results from the cell viability of polyesters in normal cells, specific cytotoxicity to cancer cells, solubility in wide range of organic solvents, low molecular weight and viscosity, these are all favorable properties to explore these bioactive aliphatic polyesters as a potential anti-cancer active drug carrier systems or anti-cancer drugs. So the further study is focused on the in vivo application and drug loading properties of the polyesters. These are the references we refer, and thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for the presentation. Any questions from the reviewers, Saeed?
Yeah, I have one question. A nice presentation. So I have a quick question. So what is the degradation mechanism of this polymer? Have you tested that? So if you're going to use them as a biomaterial, how do they degrade? Is it like enzymatic? Or how do you think it is going to degrade? Second, is it like bulk degradation or is it like surface erosion? So what kind of mechanism will it follow?
So these polyesters, they are due to their physical nature, the polyesters are liquid and waxy solids, sir. So we thought of incorporating a cross-linker. With the help of the cross-linker, we're able to prepare a membrane. And for these membranes, we're able to check their in vitro degradability using a phosphate buffer system or in an alkaline degradation can also be studied. That enzymatic degradation is also going to be studied in further.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions?
Have you checked the the effect on normal cell lines?
Yes, sir. We checked the effect on the normal human embryonic kidney cells. It's a normal cell lines.
HEK. Okay.
Okay. I want to take one question from the participants.
That, yes,
what is the conditions taken into consideration for selection of cell lines? And what are the metabolic effect of the polyester at the cellular level?
Can you repeat the question? What is the condition?
What is the condition taken into consideration for the selection of cell lines?
Yes,
and second is, what is the metabolic effect of the polyester at the cellular level?
Yes, so for the first question, that to select their cell line, so based on their effects, ma'am, that in case of cancer, that liver cancer is playing in a third row, liver cancer is in the third place. So we thought of checking its application in an human liver cancer cells. And for their degradation, the polyesters will completely undergo an in the first line also, that they completely the polyesters are in a physiological condition, they would fissure into indissoluble pieces and they may be absorbed or metabolized in vivo. So the polyester, it undergo an hydrolysis reaction.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Now we will move to our next presentation. Our next presentation will be by Dr. Piyush Kumar Gupta from Department of Life Science, Sharda University. Over to Piyush Kumar Gupta. So please share your screen.
Yeah, sure, ma'am. So am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so can I start?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So thank you very much, first of all, to all the organizers and participants to take part in this conference. And I am Dr. Piyush Kumar Gupta. I am working in Department of Life Sciences, School of Basic Sciences and Research, Sharda University. It is located at the Greater Noida, Uttar Pradesh. And this work I have carried out from my PhD also. So I have proceeded this work finally completed into the Sharda University. So the questions before going to the topic, the questions comes, are the polymeric nanomaterials are safe or not? So actually, like previously speaker has told about the polyester synthesis and they use the polycondensation methods. But if you talk about the industry and you take over the polymer industry, you will see a lot of polyester synthesis is carried out by like chemical methods. They use the metal catalysts. If you use the metal catalysts, so what will happen? These metal catalysts can be found in the end products if used at a large scale. And when these metal catalysts enter into the environment, it can be toxic to the flora and fauna both. So if we take the examples like organisms, so you can see this metal catalyst can affect on the individual molecules levels, where this can produce the DNA damage and other types of genotoxic effects. Then this effect can be seen at the cellular levels, and this cellular levels effect can be finally seen on the organs and organisms. That can lead to the many different types of diseases or metabolic disorders like cancer, cardiovascular diseases, metabolic disorders, and other types of diseases. So as I have talked about the polymer synthesis, where I have discussed about the polyester synthesis, so where we use the metal catalysts, how we can remove this metal catalyst from the synthesis. So we can synthesize the polyesters without the metal catalyst, and that should be the metal free. Also in the functionalization step, if you see, you use the functional linkers. These linkers should be biocompatible in nature. If these are not biocompatible in nature, so what will happen? This can give the toxicity to the normal cells also when during we are using for the biomedical applications. So what we have carried out, we have taken the synthesis using the metal-free approach, and we have synthesized the semi-aromatic polyesters. So for that, we have taken the two monomers. One is the cyclohexene oxide that leads to the linear copolymer synthesis. Second, we have taken the phthalic anhydride that is generally used in the drug delivery methods. So what we have taken, we have told about the metal-free synthesis. So we have used the non-metallic activators like a triethyl borane and PPNCL, where triethyl borane works as a Lewis acid and PPNCL works as a Lewis base. So this Lewis pair as a highly active non-metallic catalyst. And the mechanism of synthesis was the anionic ring opening copolymerization reactions. Or what was the monomer and Lewis pair ratio? This was the 30:30, 1:1 was the Lewis pair ratio. So you can see in this cartoon, when we have taken the CHO, cyclohexene oxide, and phthalic anhydride, and in the presence of non-metallic activators, it leads to the synthesis of poly-CHO alternating PA copolymers. But before telling that this is the alternating copolymer or block copolymers, we have to characterize it by some physicochemical characterizations. So as you can see in this PAN proton NMR analysis, you can see that there is a peak is at 5.137. This single peaks indicates that this polymer contains the Valdida alternating structures. It does not contain any polyether linkages or any aliphatic ethers. As you can see, there is no peak between the 3.0 to 3.3 ppm. Other than this, you can see the cyclohexene ring peaks in the right side of the 5 ppm. And on the more than 5 ppm, you can see the aromatic peaks also. So when we carried out the we want to calculate the molecular weight of these polymers. So what we have taken out, So what we have carried out, we have used the gel permeation chromatography. Was the 1.27. It indicates that the polymer has the equal length of chains. So when we carried out the butter contact angle analysis, so during the butter contact angle analysis, we have carried out the sessile methods. In this sessile methods, we have seen that poly-CHO alternating PA copolymers were found in amphipolic in natures when we compared with the control, where we used the glass surface. So how we carried out the fabrication of nanodrug carriers? So we have carried out the fabrication of nanodrug carriers via dialysis methods. As you can see in these diagrams, what we have taken out, we have taken the copolymer drug solutions. We have dissolved into the chloromethanol chloroform mixtures. That was the 12.5, 87.5. So after dissolving this copolymer drug solution, we have put into the waters. And after putting into the waters, it makes the two types of it makes the two like one core and one cell structures. So after nanoparticle preparations, what we have carried out, we have taken the probe sonications. Where probe sonications, you can see here, like after probe sonications, the particles convert into the monodisperse conditions. So it does not agglomerate actually. And then after that, we have carried out the dialysis method so to remove the organic solvents. And what we did in the finally, we have taken the powders, we have taken the nanoparticle drug solutions. So nanoparticles, drug encapsulated, and we have taken the drug, we have taken the lyophilizers, and we have done the lyophilization of this in the form of powder. So this curcumin nanoparticles contains the 5:1 ratio. So what we have taken out before the biomedical applications, we have to check the biocompatibility, hemocompatibility, biodegradation, biodegradation property of these nanoparticles. So what we have taken is that we have synthesized blank nanoparticles also, and we have checked the biocompatibility on this on the PBMC cells, like peripheral blood mononuclear cells, and we found that at the higher concentration we were seeing the viability of the cells was more than 80%, which indicates that our copolymeric nanoparticles were biocompatible in natures. When we carried out hemocompatibility test, we have carried out on 2% RBC solutions, and we have seen that there is no hemolysis, more significant hemolysis on different concentrations. We used 1.25, 2.50, 5 mmg and 10 mg concentrations. So according to the clinical standards, if we see any concentration hemolysis, if we see at any concentration hemolysis less than 5%, that concentration can be used for the clinical applications. So according to that, our 5 mg concentration can be used for the clinical applications, so which contains the hemocompatibility properties. Then we checked the biodegradation assay. So in biodegradation assay, we checked the biodegradability of this copolymeric nanoparticles in PBS. Also, we checked into the serum containing mediums. We found that this the particle size of the nanoparticles was decreasing with the time, and also the zeta potential was decreasing with the time. When we calculated that, checked the size of the nanoparticles into the time imaging, we found that these nanoparticles were core cell in structures, and the physicochemical properties also be calculated, like hydrodynamic size, polydispersity index, which were 272 nanometer the hydrodynamic size, and polydispersity was 0.3, which shows that there was dispersity in the molecular dispersity in the average size of the nanoparticles. But zeta potential was 30 - 30.30, because the negative charge is on the surface of the nanoparticles. This was due to the anionic monomer. And
Dr. Pius, efficiency.
Yes.
Sorry, sir. Interrupt. 8 minutes is over. So kindly.
Yes, sir. I finish soon.
Yeah, thank you.
So the drug loading efficiency was 13%, and when we carried out in vitro drug release assay, we see that this is the percentage of cumulative curcumin release was low and sustained release BBR, and we did not see any initial burst. When we taken the drug kinetic modelings, so drug release kinetic modeling, we found that PPAS is the best fitting models, and it was showing the anomalous transport. We also carried out the intracellular drug uptake assay. From that, where we found that the curcumin nanoparticle uptake is higher in comparison to the free curcumins, and which was found in the cervix cancer cells. And then we have carried out the anti-tumor effect on 2D and 3D cancer models. So we have carried out on different cancers, like lung cancers, pancreatic cancers, and liver cancers. But here I have shown only on the liver cancers, where the curcumin nanoparticles has higher anti-tumor effect in comparison to the free curcumin, because it's showing the less IC50 value. To recapitulate this validate this data, we have carried out on the 3D tumor models. We have made the tumor spheroids on the 3D, and we have seen that the size of the size in the case of curcumin nanoparticles decreased of tumor spheroids higher in comparison to the curcumin in comparison to the free curcumin and control. So when we carried out the in vivo acute and systemic toxicity study, we have carried out this in the BioBalbsi mice models, and in the systemic toxicity we found that the size of the bait of the mice is increasing with the day, and which indicates that there is no systemic toxic effect on the mice. And when we checked out using the different tissues, like a brain, heart, kidney, liver, lung, and spleens, we found that there was no toxic effect on the tissues also. So in conclusion, you can see that I have synthesized the metal-free synthesis nanoparticles, and these nanoparticles.
Hi, Piyush.
Do tumor models also, and that systemic toxicity on the mice. So thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you so much for your presentation. It was very interesting presentation. So the floor is open for questions now. So maybe I can start off with one question.
Yes, sir.
Is the mechanism of nanoparticle fabrication using this polymer?
Sir, nanofabrication, actually I use the dialysis methods. So what we happens, if you dissolve in the organic solvent these copolymers and the drug, so drugs and copolymers are dissolved in the hydrophobic, like a non-polar solvent. So when this we dissolve this copolymer or drug in the non-polar solvent, what we have taken the beaker, in that we have taken the water 20 ml, and we drop by put the this copolymer drug solutions into the water. So what will happen when it will go inside the water? So it will make the hydrophobic core or hydrophilic core. So hydrophobic core is inside, that is called core, and hydrophilic surface is outside, that is forms the cells. So when you see in the TAM image, you will see the core cell structure. So
yeah, basically it is self-assembly,
like
right?
Method for the nanofabrication synthesis.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, I have one question.
I have a question.
Dr. Piyush.
Samit, please go ahead.
Yes, Dr. Piyush, very exhaustive work. Can you hear me, Dr. Piyush? Hello, Dr. Piyush, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, I can hear you.
Yeah, so yeah, I must congratulate you for very exhaustive work. I have one question from you, one curiosity-like question.
Yes, sir.
So you said that the anti-cancer activity of bulk curcumin was less than the system that you prepared. So
yes,
what could be the possible reason for this? Because the bioactive compound seems to be curcumin. So when curcumin is present as such, not encapsulated in the nanoparticle, what could be the reason of...
Sir, actually, when I use the free curcumin, so it is not bioavailable easily. So it will not enter into the cells which amount. In that amount, nanoparticles will enter into the cells. And when curcumin will not enter into the cells, it cannot show the more cytotoxic activities. So, but when we take the nanoparticles enter into the cell via receptor mediated cytosis. So, yeah. Also goes via the endocytosis also. So the particle uptake is higher in comparison to the free curcumin, because free curcumin cannot diffuse easily into the cells. That's why we see less toxicity.
So did you also see the same thing in cellular uptake of curcumin? Nanoparticle. Did you see this?
Yes, sir. I saw that thing also. That's why I saw that there was less uptake free curcumin inside the cancer cells in comparison to the nanoparticles uptake.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Piyush. With want of time, let us wind up this thing. Thank
sure,
you so
sir.
Much for your excellent presentation. Let's go to the next speaker. Mr. Unnikrishnan from Regional Cancer Center, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir. Yeah, thank you, sir. Thanks.
Yeah, please take. Yeah, please go ahead.
So, thank you. Thank you for the organizers. So good afternoon. The title of my presentation is Folic Acid Conjugated Polysaccharide Anoxo Nanoparticle, a new platform for the mandible mediated liquid biopsy. So generally we know the CTC, that is circulating tumor cells, which is originated from the primary tumor, gets migrated through the blood vessels and gets home to the particular region to form a secondary tumor, which corresponds to different states of cancers. So generally what will happen is the cells that gets exudes from the particular portion gets migrates and gets settles and forms the secondary tumor. So if we can identify the CTC, then this is an early diagnosis of staging the cancer to progressive levels. So for that purpose, we want and micro biomarker for identify the CTCs. So generally from the literature, folate receptor is one of the biomarker that is highly expressed in CTCs that can effectively early diagnose the presence of lung cancer, bladder cancer, as well as different types of cancers. So we have chosen the identification of CTCs using the folate molecule. And if you want to target a folate molecule, you want a nanocarrier. So for my current study, I have chosen magnetic nanoparticles, which has a versatile applications in superabundant nature, as well as it can be used for biomolecule separations, MR imaging, hypothermia, and drug delivery. So in the current study, I have employed most of the applications of this magnetic nanoparticles using the folic acid as a targeting moiety. So hypothesis of my study is that bare iron oxide nanoparticles produce maximum cytotoxicity. So in order to reduce the cytotoxicity, I have coated the iron oxide with a biopolymer, which is isolated from seed kernel of Tamarindus indica, which is the Indian dates. Second hypothesis, in order to isolate a tumor cell, it is actually, it's an expensive thing if you're considering the fluorescence or the luminescence-based techniques. So to make it more easy, to make it more theranostic approach, I have used magnetic nanoparticles with a folate as a targeting moiety. So work plan, initially I have isolated the polysaccharide, which is termed as PSC001. Chemically, it is galactosyloglucan from seed kernel of Tamarindus indica. The PSC001 was conjugated with folic acid by steric esterification reaction. After conjugation, I have physically characterized using different characterization technique. In vitro study was carried out to study the cell viability as well as live dead staining. XYO cell sorting has also employed. In vivo experiment was carried out to find out its toxicological effects as well as MRI potential and tumor reduction potential. So initially, folic acid was activated by EDC chemistry. After activation, it was reacted with the galactosyloglucan, which is isolated from seed kernel of Tamarindus indica. So that what happens, an esterification reaction occurs and folic acid gets grafted to the galactosyloglucan moiety, which was confirmed by UV visible spectroscopy with a grafting percent of 5.55%. And NMR spectra also shows that the conjugate has both the peaks of folic acid as well as PSC001, that shows a successful conjugation of folic acid to the hydroxyl moiety of the galactosyloglucan. FTR spectrum also shows that the conjugate has the both aromatic peaks of folic acid as well as hydroxyl peaks of the PSC001 or the polysaccharide, that shows successful conjugation. After the synthesis of this conjugate, we have modified the surface of iron oxide nanoparticles using these folic acids. So for that purpose, I have chemically conspired the iron oxide nanoparticle coated with the folic acid, which is grafted on the polysaccharide. It was characterized using UV spectroscopy. That shows the characteristic peak of folic acid in the nanoparticles. The TEM image shows the size of about 10 to 15 nanometer nanoparticles. And we have carried out MRI phantom imaging that shows that with increasing concentration of nanoparticles, there was increased contrast of T2 imaging. That shows us this system of nanoparticles can also be used for the MRI applications for the detection of the cancer. Biocompatibility assay was carried out for both hemolysis as well as lymphocyte proliferation assay. Hemolysis shows that less than 1% RBC lysis was exhibited. That shows that according to ISO standards, it is a high. It can be used for translational purposes. Lymphocyte proliferation, there was an increased WBC proliferation with increased concentration, maybe due to the immunomodulatory effect of the polysaccharide from seed kernel of Tamarindus indica, which is a coating surface modified molecule of the iron oxide nanoparticles. Then we go for the in vitro cell viability analysis. We have chosen four cell lines, out of which three is folic acid receptor positive, one is folic acid receptor negative, FF1 is folic acid receptor negative. So that it shows that folic acid receptor positive cell shows significant increase in the cell death with increased concentration as well as increased time point, while folic acid receptor negative cell line doesn't show that much of significant cell death. That shows that the particles are targeting in an receptor mediated manner. So our literature states that iron oxide nanoparticles, when it enters, it can produce ROS production. So in order to confirm that ROS production, we have done the live dead staining as well as the annexing expression. In live dead staining, we can see that folic acid receptor positive cell line shows maximum cell death, that is red cells, compared to the control cells, while the folate receptor cell line is not showing that much of cell death. Annexin is not significantly increased. That shows that cell is not dying only due to annexin-mediated cell death or caspase-mediated death. It may be due to some other pathway. So generally, iron oxide can induce cell death by the ferroptosis pathway. So how ferroptosis is activated by the ROS generation? For that purpose, we have analyzed the ROS production in folic acid receptor positive and negative cell line. Folic acid receptor positive cell line, both qualitatively as well as quantitative, there was an increased fluorescence of the ROS that shows that when the nanoparticles are treated, the cells tend to produce the ROS that in turn cause lipid peroxidation and cause the ferroptosis death of the cell. That may be the reason of the anti-tumor effect of these nanoparticles if it is internalized. If it is not internalized, you can use it for the bioseparation process. So to identify whether the particle is entering, we have doped these nanoparticles with the doxorubicin, which is a fluorescent dye, fluorescent chemotherapeutic drug, which can also act as a tracker dye. And then we have stained the cells with the LysoTracker, which is a green color, DAPI, which is a blue color, and rhodamine filter that will show the doxorubicin fluorescence. That shows us the particles are entering through the endosomal uptake, and it will be present in the lysosome. That shows that particle can enter the cancer cell. It can bind to the surface and can enter if you are increasing the incubation time and can cause the cytotoxicity. Then the toxicology evaluation was carried out. The nanoparticles was treated consecutively for 14 days. On the 15th day, we have sacrificed and collected the blood by cardiac puncture. We have carried out both hematological and biochemical parameter analysis. In both control as well as anoxidant nanoparticle treated group, doesn't have that much of increase. Next, we have done, since it has an MRI property, we have created a HeLa xenograft mice model. We have injected the nanoparticles. After 4 hours in the MR imaging, there was an increased contrast. T2 contrast was observed, which is not present in the control. That shows that this system can also be used as an contrast MRI contrast agent. Then in vivo tumor, since we have doped it with the doxorubicin, the chemotherapy drug, we have developed a DLA, that is Dalton's lymphoma assay solid tumor model, mice model. We have injected the nanoparticles at an interval of 3 days for 5 times. And after that, we have sacrificed and taken the tumor and weight was analyzed. We can find out that with the administration of our nanoparticles, there was a significant decrease in the tumor compared to the control, which is untreated mice. And when the drug is doped to the same nanoparticle, there was much more significantly decreased tumor burden in the mice. That shows that if the nanoparticle as such or can or with the drug, it can act as an in vivo tumor reducing agent. Next, our application, that is cell sorting application. For that, we have taken the DLA cells from the peritoneal cavity of the mice after propagation. After that, we have incubated this with the ionoxin nanoparticles, that is folic acid concentrated ionoxin nanoparticle, magnetically separated. Supernatant was collected using pipetting. Then the separated cells were stained for the presence of ionoxide particles on the surface by pearl staining or Prussian blue staining, and Western blotting was carried out to find out whether the folic acid receptor is present in the separated cells or not. So pearl staining shows that these are the control cell, that is without the ionoxin nanoparticle. And this is ionoxin nanoparticle after the separation. So we can see that the blue color, that is ionoxin nanoparticles due to the pearl staining, it is bound to the surface of the cells. Also, the cells get agglomerated. That shows that by the application of the magnetic field, the cells get agglomerated. So this technique can also be used for the cell sorting applications of the cancer cell or CTCs. So this is a Western blot. In supernatant, there was no folic acid receptor. In separated residue, there was folic acid receptor. That shows that the cells are separated is exhibiting or expressing the folic acid receptor. So we can conclude that this is one of the effective system, and it is a versatile system. It is a nanotheranostic system in which it can act as a therapeutic agent, MRI agent, as well as a cell sorting agent. And also nowadays, magnetic particles based viral RNA extraction methods are also used for the efficient detection. Srijitra is also developing certain instrumentations for the for doing the PCR using the magnetic field nanoparticles based separation of SARS-CoV. So this separation method can also be employed in virology also. So these are the references. So this is my acknowledgement and thank you.
So thank you, Unnikrishna. So I'm Dr. Satya Prakash. I want to ask one question. So what are the different reactive oxygen species which are generating, and how they are generating? What is the mechanism behind that? Can you explain?
So generally it's a Fenton reaction. So generally it will be oxygen radicals. So normally the cancer cell will have a hydrogen peroxide levels, intracellular hydrogen peroxide levels. So those that have hydrogen peroxide levels will interact with the iron, so will produce the oxide radicals or oxygen radicals that can lead to the lipid peroxide, that is membrane damage and lipid peroxide that can be the reason for the ferroptosis. So in order to identify which all enzymes or which all the compounds, I think we should go for further LCMS and also something in the cellular level to find out how far these mechanisms are occurring.
So as you are using DCFDA dye, right? Yeah. So that can significantly figure out what are the different reactive oxygen species are there. So that's why I have asked the question.
Oh, yeah. Generally, one of the main things we have actually analyzed different radical studies. And from that, we can only get the oxygen radical is the basic one that is causing the death. We have also focused on nitric oxide radical, but I didn't get any significant results for the damage caused by nitric oxide. So I think it's oxygen radical maybe the main factor.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
So Unnikrishnan, can you go back to your title slide, the first slide? I missed the title of your presentation.
very first one. So you didn't talk about the liquid biopsy. I mean, I was hoping that you will show some result on
actually
finding out circulating DNA or something like that.
Yeah, actually we have done the result, but due to some ethical issues, I can't actually, because I have done in the human samples. So
my question will be on this. So this method, magnetic field method, so how sensitive and how accurate this will be in liquid biopsy in catching, let us say, circulating DNA or circulating cells in the system? So what is the specificity, sensitivity, and accuracy?
Yeah, actually, one of when we carry out the different trials, we only got about 47% of retrieval of cells from the whole sets of cancer cells. When we carry out manually, and we have done a small instruments using this magnetic field. And for increasing the efficiency, actually, just like a flow cytometer, just like MAX, magnetic assisted cell sorter, we are planning to develop a system in which the nanoparticles will be flowing in a microfluidic device, and the cells will be sorted based on that one. So that for that purpose, we are actually contacting some engineers, because accuracy is not that much, because we are carrying out just manually the separation. So accuracy is not that much. So this technique is just a pioneer experiment. So to make it more prominent, to make it more efficient, we require some engineering or engineer people for having that increasing the efficiency.
Fine, thank you.
I want to take one question from the participants. That what is the circulating time of this nanoparticle in vivo condition?
We have done the biodistribution. It was around 72 hours, because since it's a polysaccharide coated, generally these particles gets engulfed by the macrophages or maybe accumulate in the liver. So that is one of the drawback. To make it more escape from this reticuloendothelial system, we are trying to coating with a PEG, polyethylene glycol, so that it will be escaped from this reticuloendothelial system, so that it will be more efficient. It is only 72 hours and we are getting the signal of the fluorescent dye, which is conjured with the system.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions?
No, ma'am.
Okay, so
very basic question. So when you talk of early detection, do you feel all sorts of primary cancers will give rise to circulating tumor cells?
Sorry, sir.
Do you feel that all types of cancers will give rise to circulating tumor cells?
No.
When you talked about early detection.
No, not every cells actually. For that purpose, actually, by my concern, actually, CTC is developed only by certain cancers, and the mechanism also varies actually. From cancer to cancer, actually, the generation of CTC varies. And the all primary tumor is not tends to produce a CTC actually. Generally, if in case of breast cancer, most of the breast cancer in the stage of 2 or 3, it tends to produce a CTCs, get migrates and forms a secondary tumors in bone or the brain. So in certain cases, it is not producing, and the mechanism differs actually from cancer to cancer. CTC generation is differing. Not all primary tumor is generating CTCs actually.
Okay, so then it's difficult to be used for an early detection tool, right? It's just difficult
It's actually difficult, but here I have used folic acid as the conjugation molecule. So we can use EGFR in exchange of folic acid. So it depends on which CTC or which biomarker we have to analyze. We have to change the ligand molecule actually. Here folic acid for folate receptor positive. So if we are using EGFR,
we can talk offline. I think time is short. So we can talk offline. Thank you.
Thank you, Unikrishnan. Then we will move to our next presentation. And the presentation is by D. Balamani from JNTUA, Anantapuram. So ma'am, please kindly share your slide. Okay.
Am I audible now?
Yes.
Just a minute. Okay. Okay. Good afternoon, everyone.
My name is Dibala Nagmani. I'm a research scholar from JNT Anandapur. I'm here to tell you about my project, my project work. It's a comparative in vivo assessment of HTMI bersodiol combined nanoformulation with the conventional dosage forms. And I did this in this research under the supervision of Professor Dr. K. Bhaskar Reddy Garu and K. Sheshamaneshwarama ma'am. And here, this is the brief outline what I want. And here, while coming to the objectives, I want to get a enhanced drug. I want to get my formulation with get enhanced drug permeability and bioavailability. Along with that, to compare my formulation with the marketed formulations and to have a justification with in vivo studies. These are the physical physicochemical characteristics and I checked the melting point and solubility, etc. Actually, the solubility has main effect on the physicochemical characters, the characteristics and drug permeability along with the bioavailability. I checked with the these ersodiol and HTMI both are poorly soluble drugs. And that's the main problem for these drugs. And I went with the solubility with the water along with the additional by keep on addition with the ethanol at a particular point of 5 to 10% of additional ethanol to the water, I achieved a better complete soluble drug. And then I went with the formulation process. And before that, we need to check the drug and excipient compatibility studies. I did it with the FTIR studies. While coming to the drug and compatibility, drug excipient compatibility, we had different peaks over here, and main peaks were not at all changed. Those are characteristic peaks of ersodiol and HTMI, and these ersodiol and HTMI characteristic peaks are very as usual and not yet changed. This indicates that there won't be any change in the drug and excipients while it is in a mixture or else while it is in a form of mixture or else a separate drug and excipient alone, whatever it might be, there won't be any interactions or any other changes. So it means it's a good compatibility we achieved. And then I choose for the preparation work. For preparation, I went with the polymer and surfactant. I choose an HPMC as my polymer. Why? Because of main reason. HPMC is a biopolymer. Along with that, it has a good control release nature by itself. If we are going for the NDDS, in NDDS we need to go with the better polymer, which gives you a better control release nature. So for that, I went with the HPMC. And next, I taken polyoxomer as my surfactant because of its high redispersibility and good stability. And with these excipients, I went with the different timings and speed of homogenization, time of homogenization along with the sonication time. I went with the method combination of high speed homogenization and ultrasonication homogenization. These combination will give you a better formulation because rotor stator homogenization gives you a shearing effect, which can cut off larger particles which were formed during the formulation, with the preparation, which will give a uniform homogeneity. And we'll went with the ultrasonication, which will give you a high frequency oscillations, which were done because of the piezoelectric effect, and this will give you a constant mobility, which will lead to stable compound. Next, I did an optimization method by design of experiment with the response surface method, and here I choose an homogenization time, speed, and sonication time as the critical process attributes, and polymer ratio, surfactant as the critical material attributes. And critical quality attributes includes particle size and PI will affect the polydispersive index, both affects the drug loading capacity, and zeta potential will affect entrapment efficiency. Along with that, control release nature, and then Z average will affect the redispersibility and stability of the compound. So these are the outputs of DOE. Because of the time, I didn't explain everything in DOE. And here, while coming to the 3D graph, it will give a relation between the attributes, that means process and material attributes towards the quality attributes. This indicates the optimizer condition. Here the point indicates the optimizer conditions, and we can easily check if it is any increment or decrement, how the effect would be. And the counter plot shows interactions between each factors. It may be material attribute, or else it might be process attributes, how the interactions between one to the other. And these are the optimizer method what I chosen, and what optimizer method given by the DOE. And this is the characterizations. I had a good particle distribution along with that mobility. And DSC report has shown these peaks, which indicates endothermic peaks at 163 degrees and 203 degrees centigrade. And I had a same report which has both characteristic natures of HTMI and ersodiol. While coming to the XRD report, in ersodiol pure form, we'll have a crystalline nature, and that serial peaks will be present in between 5 to 20. But in nanoformulation, we don't have the crystalline nature, and we don't find the peaks because of the crystalline nature changes to amorphous nature. And here, while coming to the in vitro assessment, we done with the two methods. One is using trans diffusion cell, and here we have the trans diffusion cell, and the ex vivo permeation studies done with the goat intestinal membrane. Here the membrane sandwiched between the donor and the receptor compartments, and analysis time was done for 6 hours. And while we apply the drug solid matrix, like here, if we consider this is a membrane, we'll apply the solid matrix, and only the permeated drug will move from the up to down. And that can be analyzed by taking a sample out of the sampling area, and that at 30 minutes interval in ex vivo permeation studies, and 2 hours interval in in vitro studies. And ex vivo studies are done for 6 hours, and in vitro studies done for 24 hours. And in ex vivo studies, we used the goat intestine membrane, and in vitro studies, we used a synthetic cellulose ester membrane, which was Wattman company. And here, after attachment of all this together, the experiment has to be maintained at 32 degrees centigrade, and 32 plus or minus 1 degree centigrade at a speed of 600 RPM. And we used PBS, ethanolic PBS of pH 7.4 as a solvent. And after the permeation, after the analysis, we'll get the amount present, amount permeated, and amount released. While we go with the time versus percentage of drug release, this is the curve what we have. And if we see to this, these in vitro studies of nanoformulation at 3 replicates shown this peak. And while this pink peak of HTMI shown around 35.42%, and while coming to the ersodiol, it shows around 27.98%. And this increment in the drug release, percentage of drug release, will give you the effective nature of nanoformulation. And it will give the main effect of formulation. And here, this effect can be justified with the in vivo studies. For in vivo studies, I took 6 groups of 6 animals, each of albino vista rats of 230 plus or minus of 20 milligrams. And I went with the treatment for 10 days. After the 10 days, we took the blood by retroorbital puncture, and we collected the serum, and then we went for HPLC analysis to check the parameters of SGPT, SGOT, and ALT, and other parameters. And here, this is the biochemical estimation of serum levels, and this is a plasma time versus plasma concentration curve. This is the pharmacodynamic characters, and these are the pharmacokinetic characters. Here I mentioned all the pharmacokinetic characters, such Tmax, area under curve, T half, and MRT. And here, while we check the time versus plasma concentration, if we take a marketed formulation, the marketed formulation will reach to maximum dose within 5 to 6 hours, and then it immediately reduces its effect. And for this effect, we need to take the dose frequently and to maintain the effective dose concentration. While we coming to the nano drug formulation, it reaches minimum effective concentration within 6 to 6 hours, and it maintains till 22 hours, and that indicates the main use of ARSO and ezetimibe nano formulation. As we don't have ezetimibe ARSO-diol nano formulation in the market, we went with the available separate marketed formulations. And these pharmacokinetic studies done with the help of PK solver. While coming to the histopathology, ezetimibe and ARSO nano. Hello?
Kindly wind up.
Okay. This is the thing what we observed in the histopathology. First, we checked with the normal parameters, and along with that, we want to prove with the hepatoprotective activity. And meanwhile, we came to know that it can go with the NASH treatment also, because of the vacuoles here and in the diseased group were not there in the nano formulation of treated group. So that can be used for the obesity. This includes my future work because of these. For the confirmation of these ones, we need to go with the molecular studies. And by conclusion, we had around 4 to 5 fold increment in bioavailability and percentage of F release. That means percentage of release around 19.35% compared to the ezetimibe, and 14.60% towards the ARSO-diol. And it has maintained its concentration more than 20 hours. It means it's better to go with the nano formulation instead of going for the marketed drug, which we are taking around 300 to 400 mg per day. It's around 3 doses, which may cause more toxic effects in the body. And these are the references. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Any questions from the reviewers? Yes. Okay. Thank you very much, ma'am, for this wonderful presentation. Due to shortage of time, we want to conclude this first round of oral presentation of this afternoon session. Now, we will move to the second round of this afternoon session. Before that, I want to thank all the reviewers and all the presenters for their wonderful presentation. The second round will be hosted by Dr. Ronak Kumar Das. So over to Dr. Ronak Kumar.
Thank you, Dr. Sunita. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to the organizers. Our next speaker for the next round session would be Dr. Yoita Prabhu Nath, who is an associate professor at the Department of Oral and Maxillofacial Pathology, Vivekananda Dental College for Women. Dr. Yoita, please.
Yes, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible.
Yes.
Please go ahead.
Yes. I myself, Dr. Yoita Prabhunath, take this digital platform to present my topic, Neurotrophins and Neurotrophin Receptors, an Emerging Therapeutic Paradigm in Ameloblastoma Tumor. I feel happy and humbled to share my original research work in front of the stalwarts, research scholars, and the panelists from the various departments of science and technology. So ameloblastoma tumor, it is a benign tumor, but in India, oral cancer is considered as a major threat. But this ameloblastoma tumor, even though it is a benign tumor, it is equally sometimes more aggressive or destructive than oral cancer. And it is not a new tumor. And in last year publication, it stated that ameloblastoma was found even in dinosaurs, which has the fossils dated earlier between 67 to 69 million years. And even in Egyptian mummies, they found evidence of ameloblastoma. This is one such tumor which had so much of confusion and went across so much of confusion to attain its terminology. And why I'm taking this topic as my research work was, as you see in this radiograph, you can able to see a 4 into 3 centimeter of radiolucency in this orthopantomogram. And for this, if it is cancer, the minimal resection surgery is enough, but it needs a hemimandibulectomy or hemisectioning of the particular bone. And for that, the patient has to undergo so much of pain, and not only pain, the patient has to go under the compromised quality of life even after the surgery. So coming back to my topic, odontogenesis is tooth development is a complex process where multiple tightly regulated genes work together in a spatial and time-bound manner in a kind of epithelial mesenchymal interaction. If there is any dysregulation or mislead in this epithelial mesenchymal interaction, this will end up in a group of tumors called as odontogenic tumors. And among these 12 odontogenic tumors, this ameloblastoma is the second most common, and it is the most aggressive, and it is the most locally destructive tumor. And this is the histopathology of ameloblastoma, where there are two patterns can be seen. The left one is the follicular pattern, and the right one is plexiform type of pattern. Coming to the incidence, the world incidence of odontogenic tumor is 40% in there and around. And in South India, it is 56%, and in Tamil Nadu, it is around 69 or 68%. Recently in 2004, till date for ameloblastoma, surgery is considered as the only treatment of choice because chemotherapy was not successful in the post-surgical or pre-surgical condition, and radiotherapy is contraindicated because it can turn this ameloblastoma into ameloblastic carcinoma, which is much more aggressive tumor. So a group of people, they came out with a BRAF mutation was found in this tumor, and they said that we have found the drug for ameloblastoma. But in the same year, the later part, there came a publication which showed the other side of the coin. Not only BRAF gene is responsible for the pathogenesis, but also PI3K AKT pathway, which is induced by nuclear factor kappa B, is also a reason for the pathogenesis. So now coming into the neurotrophins and neurotrophins receptor, it is mostly found in the neural cells and neural crest derived cells, whereas there are two neurotrophins receptor, high-end neurotrophin receptor and low-end neurotrophin receptor, which can bind with the 4 different types of neurotrophins. Based on the ligand formation of this different neurotrophins with this two particular neurotrophin receptor, the cell can either take in the way of pro-survival or apoptotic or differentiation or in the form of proliferation. So what provoked us to see or look for this neurotrophins and neurotrophins receptor in ameloblastoma? Because when we go back to odontogenesis, that is tooth development, a similar kind of cells, which is like ameloblastoma tumor cells, are seen in the odontogenesis, that is during tooth development, which helps in the development of enamel. But these cells, once it showed the positivity for neurotrophins and neurotrophin receptors, till it starts producing its matrix deposition. But once if it attains its functional maturity and if it starts producing the matrix, that is enamel, the positivity or the immunoreactivity is lost in that cells. So similar kind of cells were appreciated in amyloblastoma, that is immature amyloblast like cells. So that is what made us to think, so why it couldn't be the role of neurotrophins and neurotrophins receptor which play a major role in the pathogenesis of amyloblastoma. So all through the decades, various researchers has coming out with different types of molecular pathology which lacks the rhythmic correlation between each other. So with this objective, we want to find out, the detect and analyze the neurotrophin receptor and neurotrophins in amyloblastoma and to compare it between the follicular and plexiform type. So what is the novelty? So it can easily translate into the patient care and which can eliminate the extensive surgery. So proper ethical committee clearance was obtained from the Institutional Ethical Board, and the control is used, neural tissue is used as the control. So this was our first publication we did in amyloblastoma tissue, P75 neurotrophin receptor, where the P75 were positive only for the follicular amyloblastoma, whereas the plexiform amyloblastoma lacks the P75 NTR expression. And later, out of curiosity, we went into a tyrosine kinase receptor, whereas the positivity was seen in only in plexiform, whereas the follicular amyloblastoma shows total negativity. And one of the neurotrophin is neuronal growth factor, NGF. It was found in both follicular and plexiform, but it was extensively seen in plexiform type. When we go back to the literature, this P75 neurotrophin receptor in gastric cells, gastric cancer cells, and also in hepatocellular carcinoma, it downregulated the progression of the tumor, whereas tyrosine kinase receptor, it aggravated the progression of the tumor. The same thing was replicated in amyloblastoma. Follicular tumor is less aggressive comparing to that of the plexiform amyloblastoma. So this is what the signaling pathway which we are trying to achieve. These are all the tyrosine kinase pathway, tyrosine kinase receptor, and this is the neurotrophin, P75 neurotrophin receptor. When the neurotrophins comes and attaches with either these neurotrophin receptors, it can either take the tumor towards MAPK pathway, or else it can take the tumor to the nuclear factor kappa B pathway. And we thank the ICMR for accepting our study, and it is in a state where we have submitted our budget proposal. And to conclude, this is what the CBCT image of the first case which I projected in the first slide. So the patient has to undergo so much of pain. Oh, so the world is looking for a cure, that is a non-surgical treatment of amyloblastoma. So with all this finding out of this molecular pathogenesis, we can silence the gene or switch on that some tumor suppressor gene or some silence the oncogenes, and finally we could end up for the betterment of the mankind with the non-surgical treatment of amyloblastoma. Thank you. And thank the organizers for giving the opportunity to present my work in this digital platform. Thank you.
Really nice presentation, Dr. Yotab. I have just two questions, very basic ones. How did you find, what was the normal samples that you obtained? And was there any inclusion-exclusion criteria followed?
Sir, actually, we took the neural tissue as a control tissue because we didn't took any odontogenesis tissue, because it is already proven and it is there in the literature. It was there in the human odontogenesis and also in the rodent odontogenesis. The expression has been proved. So based on that, we created a hypothesis that the same similar kind of functional immature amyloblast has been seen in the amyloblastoma tumor. So with that question, we just proceeded this work, and it is a tender, this work is a tender, in the tender baby stage. So we are looking forward to take it to a next level.
Okay, thank you. Now the session is open for questions. If we have no other questions from the other panelists, then we'll proceed to our next speaker. Before that, I would like to thank Dr. Yota for the wonderful work, and we hope you get prosper with the drug and all those things in future. For amyloblastoma, and we can help mankind. So our next speaker would be Khushbu Dutta from the Center for Biomaterial Cellular Molecular Theranostics, VIT.
Sir, am I audible?
You're audible. Please carry on and share your screen.
Oh, one second. Good afternoon, everyone. I am Khushbu Dutta. Currently, I am pursuing my PhD under the guidance of Dr. Sunita Nayak from VIT Vellore. This presentation is based upon my preliminary work being done a few months back. The title of my presentation is Graphene Quantum Dots Based Drug Delivery System for the Osteosarcoma Therapy.
Sorry to interrupt. Can you please switch on your video, please?
Yes, one second. Yes. Now it's okay, sir.
Yes, please. Yes.
Okay. Thank you. The title of my presentation is Graphene Quantum Dots Based Drug Delivery System for Osteosarcoma Therapy. So my pointer is not working.
Yeah, it's not working.
Yeah.
Just click. Yeah.
The cursor is working. We can see that. Please go ahead.
The slide is not going ahead.
Can you stop sharing? Now it's going, actually. It's going. Yeah, please go ahead.
Okay, yeah, yes. Now, first of all, I would like to share some properties of the graphene quantum dots. The graphene quantum dots are the zero-dimensional graphene particles, which are having the characteristics of both the graphene as well as the quantum dots. These nanoparticles, these exhibit the exceptional photoluminescence properties due to the strong quantum properties. Basically, the thing is the energy band gap in the graphene quantum dots, these can be altered by changing the size as well as surface chemistry properties. My nano drug delivery system was composed of GQD, that is graphene quantum dot, as the carrier, which was complexed with hyaluronic acid and poly-L-lysine as the targeting ligand, and the drug used was doxorubicin. Each component has a specific role to play in this drug delivery system. Hyaluronic acid specifically targets CD44 receptors, which are overexpressed in the cancerous cells, and poly-L-lysine enhances the binding affinity of the GQD conjugate with the drug. And most importantly, even after the loading of the drug, still graphene quantum dots can be prepared in the nanoscale. So therefore, this will enhance the nuclear internalization process. Now, methodology. First of all, GQDs were prepared by electrochemical exfoliation method. Then GQDs were conjugated with HAPLL complex by EDC-NHS protocol. This EDC-NHS is a coupling protocol that activates the surface carboxylic groups which are present on the nanomaterial. After that, I carried out the characterization studies to determine the morphology, size, and the functional group characterization by transmission electron microscopy, FTIR, UV visible spectroscopy. And after that, the drug loading and release profiles were done. And then cell viability assay was analyzed and fluorescence microscopy assay was done. I will not go deep into the characterization studies because of the time constraint, but in short, TEM analysis, the morphology and the average size of the GQT was determined. Then the conjugation of the GQT with HAPLL conjugate was studied by using FTIR analysis and UV visible spectra. The phase transitions which are taking place within the nanoparticle are studied by using the Raman spectroscopy. Now, drug loading and release profiles. As we can see from the above graph, the drug loading standard curve was found to follow a good linear correlation. The maximum drug loading efficiency was achieved at 66% when the ratio of the drug to the conjugate, that is GQT HAPLL, was 3:5. Then the pH triggered drug release mechanisms was studied, and at pH 5, because in majority of cancer cells there is an acidic pH, and the release as high as 50% was achieved. We did the cell viability assay using MG63 cell line, which is an osteosarcoma cell line. The percent cell viability was measured in comparison to the untreated control cells. And as it is evident from the above graph, that in both the cases, in case of GQT as well as GQT HAPLL, the viability was more than 50% as compared to the control. On the other hand, the viability was significantly reduced when it was compared to the control in case of GQT HAPLL DOC system. Therefore, we can say that GQT can efficiently, this nano drug delivery system can efficiently target the cancerous cell. As I have mentioned earlier, GQDs possess the stable photoluminescence properties due to the various quantum properties. So for analyzing the bioimaging efficiency of these nanomaterials, I did fluorescence microscopy assay. From these images, it is clear that the cells which were incubated with GQD, GQD HAPLL, and GQD HAPLL DOCs, these were brighter in color and emitted green fluorescence as compared to the control cell, which didn't emit any fluorescence. So we can conclude that the real-time monitoring of the cellular uptake can be done by using GQT as a carrier. In conclusion, the GQT-based drug delivery system is a potential theranostic agent for osteosarcoma therapy. And the most important part of the research is the multimodal conjugation in case of GQDs, which will further allow for the incorporation of both the drug as well as the targeting ligand within the same nanoassembly. And thus, this will in turn minimize the systemic toxicity, which is usually associated with majority of chemotherapeutic drugs, which are used as a part of conventional chemotherapy regimen. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Khushbu, for your wonderful talk. Now the session is open for questions from the
analysts. Do I have a question?
Yes, sir.
One basic question. So EDC NHS coupling was done in aqueous or non-aqueous conditions?
So it was done in aqueous conditions.
So is it also possible to do it in non-aqueous condition? And why aqueous condition is like, why you prefer this? Any particular reason for this?
Yes, sir. Due to the I used graphene quantum dots, and due to its solubility in water, therefore I preferred the aqueous conditions for doing the EDC NHS protocol.
All right, thank you.
So I have a question.
Yes, sir.
How do you load doxorubicin in QD? So how do you, what is the mechanism of loading actually?
Sir, actually the mechanism of loading for the conjugate, that is hyaluronic acid and PLL, it was covalently conjugated with GQD. And after that, the drug loading was done non-covalently to this complex.
So there is no interaction between drug and the coating, PLL or other polymer?
So there was an interaction because GQT was conjugated first with HAPLL complex and then the drug was loaded.
Okay.
I have a question, Khushbu. So can you explain something regarding the size of the quantum dots? Show the TEM image once again. Also, there is a question from the audience regarding the PL studies, the emission and the excitation of the GKDs. So show the slide.
One second, sir. Yes, sir, this one.
Yeah.
It was
can
taken
you explain
at,
the size of the particle?
It was taken at 50, the image was taken at 50 nanometer and the average size, currently I'm not remembering, apologize for the same, but it was taken at 50 nanometer and the PL excitation spectra, it's, one second.
What is the scale bar, Khushbu, in the TM image?
It is 50 nanometer.
And the average size is around 2 to 3 nanometers, and the size range is around from 1.5 nanometer to 5.5 nanometers.
Okay, sir.
And the PL excitation and emission, they are blue, in the blue zone, they are emitting. So around 370 nanometer is the excitation and around 450 is the emission.
Emission, okay.
Please proceed, yeah.
Okay, thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Khushbu.
Thank you, sir.
So we move to our next presentation by Celcia from Agni College of Technology. Are you there?
Hi, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible, and please introduce yourself because I don't have details about you. Thank you.
Ah, okay, sir. 1 minute, sir.
Yeah, your slide is visible. Carry on.
Sir. Good evening, everyone. I am Celcia, biomedical third year, Agni College of Technology. I am a UG graduate. I'm studying UG. 1 minute, sir. It's something asking. The host has asked you. Sir, I have some problem in camera. It's okay, sir.
Yeah, carry on.
Okay, sir. My project guide is Athena Milagi Pandian. I'm like to thank you for the organizer for giving me the great opportunity. My project is about biomaterial infused tilapia skin for wound and injuries. This project is aims to, at present there is no ideal substitute in the market that provides an effective and scar-free wound healings. That's why I'm going for the tilapia skin, which has an abundant content of collagen type, collagen 1. And then it has a reduced disease transmission to human. That's why we are going for the tilapia skin for wound and injuries. It especially for, it is a primary stage of a project. It is used for only open wound injuries. Sir, is visible? Second slide.
Yeah, visible. Carry on.
Oh, okay, sir. Just a recap. Skin is the largest organ on our body, which protects the internal organs. It is made up of three layers: epidermis, dermis, and hypodermis. If the skin is wound, many substitutes to reconstruct our skin backed by two methods. One is a natural biomaterial, which is intimate by our own body cells. And second one is the synthetic biomaterial. This is the basis of wound healing. First one is hemostasis, inflammation, proliferation, and maturation. In current, we have three different types of wound dressing. One is traditional, second one is biomaterial based, and third one is artificial skin. Advantage of other methods of wound healing is it give a scar, sometimes it will leave scar, and it hardly take more time period to cure. That's why we are going for this tilapia skin biomaterial. Fish skin preparation. First step is to buy an tilapia fish and kept in a bag full of ice. And in lab, we are cleaning the skin and chopped into small fine pieces. It's about 0.5 into 0.5 centimeter. And the skin is maintained at 4 degrees Celsius temperature in a full of ice. This is the part we are going to cut the skin of tilapia fish. Next, we are going to remove the non-collagenous tissues. It is the skin already prepared is taken and added with the 50 ml of 0.1 molarity NaOH solution for 24 hours. After that, the skin is dipped in a 2 gram of salt NaOH solution with 50 ml of distilled water for 5 minutes. And again, it is refrigerated for 24 hours. After 24 hours, the solution is filtered and washed with distilled water for 4 times to make the skin neutral pH. After that washing, it is again we are treating with 250 ml of 10% butyl alcohol for 24 hours to remove the fatty tissues. Again, it is refrigerated. Again, the solution is filtered. A new 250 ml of 10% butyl alcohol was added and kept in a fridge for another 24 hours. This made the collagen produced. Here we are going to isolate the marine fish from derived collagen. Here we are using two methods, AAC method and PAC method. AAC method means acid soluble collagen method, and PAC is a pepsin soluble collagen method. When we are comparing both, PAC method is more efficient than the AAC method because pepsin, it will give a abundant content of collagen compared to AAC method. This is the flow of doing the process. Both process are same. Only is the different is we are here after removing the fat from the fish skin, we are using acetic acid for 3 days. But PAC method, we are using acetic acid and also the digested with 10% of pepsin. And after that, we are solubilizing the collagen with acetic acid, and it is centrifuging and precipitating the collagen. It is centrifuged at 5000 RPM for 10 minutes. And the final process is to remove the, put the solution in the Petri dish equally and maintain a 10 degree Celsius in a hot oven for 2 days. And it is dry, and the water content will be rain off, and the proteins will remain in a dry condition. And next, we are going to prepare a gel for the bandage. Here, we are taking the vitamin C tablet and cytosine gelatin for and the collagen powder we already prepared. We are mixing the 4 content and it placed in a petri dish and we refrigerated for a day. This is the structure. Last one, this one is the collagen content for the bandage content, bandage preparation. Why we are going for this fish collagen extraction? Why? Because it has an abundant content of type 1 collagen, which will initiate the wound healing process. Tissue engineering substance serves a promising therapeutic agent, replacing the skin lost in wounds such as burns, open wounds, thereby to initiate the wound healing process. We are going for this abundant content of collagen 1 type, tilapia fish skin. These collagen will cross-link with the physical treatment or chemical agents and other blenders and gives the scaffold like this. Output, this skin substitute will promote the wound healing process. It is mainly for the patient, diabetic patient and other open wounds. It will reduce the pain and also avoid the bacteria and fungus inside the wound. This substitute is a biodegradable recovery. The original skin, the artificial skin substitute will be peeled out after the original skin recover. In this project, we are studied a 3 different testers. First one is a drug diffusion study, which is going to determine the fish diffusion property, which is kept under the pH 7. Second test is estimations. Here we are estimating the 3 different types of materials, that is protein by using the Fabot reagent and vitamin C using ammonium molybdate. And third one is cytosine using methyl red dye. I'm not going detail because of time shortage. And next, the third test is antimicrobial activity. Here, antimicrobial activity, here we are taking the 4 different bacterial organisms, that is Pseudomonas, Proteus, E. coli, and Staphylococcus. Here, the petri dish having different types of four different types of bacteria treated with the skin. This give a good result. That is, the biomaterial has a good antibacterial effect. And third, this one is the antibacterial test at different concentration and different periods. Finally, we conclude that this skin have a type 1 collagen, which is initiate the wound healing process, and vitamin C, which is good for antioxidant, and third one, cytosine, which is good for antibacterial agent. This is the advantage of a skin substitute for wound healing, which is a fast to avoid the bacterial infection to patients. It is mainly a cost effective and widely available. We don't need to wait for the donor, and this is a 50% of our body. Similar work we are going to do that is, the skin is taken and treated with NaOH solution and dipped with the solution cytosine, vitamin C and gelatin, and directly we are going to place at the wound site for a while period. And this is the last futuristic work. This is my reference, and this is my acknowledgement. And thank you. Any questions?
Wonderful, Chelsea. You're too young, but your confidence really inspires us. We feel that science is in good hands.
Thank you so much.
Is now open for all the panelists.
Yeah. So very good presentation, actually, really impressive. Just for the audience, she was in the backup list, and the main participant did not turn up. So I had to inform her only yesterday, and just like one day, she did a very good job, actually. So
thank you, sir.
Congratulations on that.
Thank you, sir.
So I have one question. So
yes, sir.
You are using the skin peels, right? I mean,
yes,
fish
sir.
Skin peels. So why do you need all other things like gelatin, chitosan and other things? So we can just use this, right?
It will give a fast healing, sir. That's why we are going for that fast healing process. Cellulose like that, we are going for that.
Okay. So how many fish you ate while you did this experiment?
No, sir.
No?
No, sir.
Yes. Yeah, good.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, if no more questions, we'll go to our next speaker, who is Dr. Rajesh K. Gangwar from Council of Science and Technology, Uttar Pradesh, Lucknow. Dr. Gangwar, please. Are you there?
Yeah, I could see his name there. Dr. Rajesh?
Dr. Rajesh, I don't find him.
I could see in the list of...
I can see that, but...
they should call him.
Dr. Rajesh, can you hear us?
I'll quickly call him.
Maybe we can go to the next speaker, then we can come again to the person speaker.
Okay.
I guess he's the last speaker.
He was our last speaker. Yeah, he's the last speaker of the session.
Okay, then we can wait for him. Thank you.
Yeah, we have him. Welcome, Dr. Rajesh. Please share your screen. Welcome, Dr. Rajesh. Can you hear us? Uh, Welcome, Dr. Rajesh. Please share your screen.
Yeah, he's setting up the system, I guess.
Yeah. Yes, Dr. Rajesh, please go ahead. We can see your slides. Dr. Rajesh, you can please go ahead. Thank you for joining.
Can you please unmute yourself? I think he's muted. So can you please try removing your earphone? Yeah, just remove it from the system, please. Yeah, can you please try now without the earphone, just onto the system? Still, you're not audible, actually.
Could you call him, Arun?
Yeah.
Arun, probably he didn't turn it on the join with the computer audio option. Are we able to get in touch with him?
I'm just guiding him now.
Oh, sure.
It may take 2 minutes to come back for him. Rajesh, can you please try now?
He's not audible.
Yeah, yes, it's a problem. Okay, I think probably we should go further.
We don't have any more speakers, so then we.
I think we should conclude the session.
Thank you to all, and I would like to thank the organizers for allowing me to hold the reins of this session. I would like to give the powers to Dr. Loganathan to finally commence the session. Thank you.
Thank you all. First of all, I want to thank all the parties, all the oral presenting authors for their excellent presentation, as well as all the presentations contains a rich amount of scientific contents. We congratulate all the speakers for their fantastic work. We would like to thank all the chairperson and review committee members, Dr. Sathya Prakash, Dr. Arun Kumar, Dr. Amit Kumar, Dr. Raunak Kumar Das, and Dr. Sunita Nayak for the joining with us and evaluating all the presentations and all sharing this session. Thank you all. Nearly 450 participants attended this particular session. Thank you all the participants for your active participation. The next session will start at 4:15 p.m. That is the keynote speaker, keynote talk from the research director of Swansea University. Please join us in 15 minutes. Thank you all.
Thank you.
We shall be closing now. Please join us in 4:15 p.m. Keynote talk.
Yeah, thank you. Sure, thank you.